Hi guys! Previously, we talked about things we wish we knew before renovating a house. Mm-hmm. But today, we'll be touching on the topic of things we wish we knew before buying a house.
Mm-hmm. Because we were very inspired by this quote that says, it's not about how much money you have, but what you do with that money that you have. And let's say we're not even talking about investment, like people who have excess money to invest, to start up business, to, you know, do up their online store, open a cafe or whatnot. We're just talking about the very basic of like buying and owning a house, which I think most Singaporeans will think of when we hit a certain age, like us lah. So after we bought our house, there are a lot of things that we learned along the way. So hopefully today's video can give you guys some insights and some ideas on what to look out for and what to do a little bit of research on to help you guys save even more money than we did. So a little bit about how we got this home. We sort of like rushed into buying a house because we are quite not that young anymore. So we didn't want to wait another like 4 or 5 years for a BTO.
Yeah.
Mm, so we got our home for about 268,000 for a 4-room resale that is 30 years old, right?
30 years old, yes.
Mm, yeah.
And the size is around 900 square feet.
Mm-hmm. And then we heard from our friend who waited for a BTO. He got his home for around the same price as ours.
But it's brand new.
Yeah, but it's brand new. So it's like 99 years, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So if let's say you are planning to have kids and you know you want to pass the home to your kids or you're going to live in that home until you retire and whatnot, right? That home actually has more resale value or is more worth it if you want to pass it on to your kids lah.
Yes. For us, we don't plan to use our house as an investment.
Mm.
So we just want to have a place to stay, a place that call home lah, a place we call home. So we didn't even put into thought like, okay, next time this house sell already, how much will it be worth, the inflation and everything. We know that if you sell this house, I think you'll be at a loss.
Yeah, I guess. But it's a bit like you pay rental for the home loan in that case.
Yeah. Plus, I think it's affordable, 268K for us at the moment. And this brings us to the point whether you can afford your dream home, your house, okay, based on like what you currently
have. Your savings, your salary, and your CPF. Because previously, right, before we got our home, when we were looking around, right, I really wanted a condo, okay? It's very attractive because, like, the amenities are so good. When you buy the home, right, you will get all the dishwasher, the...
Like, everything is included oven. Inside. Yeah, and all the appliances. You got swimming pool, venue, you got gym, then, she got concierge also.
Yeah. Then my house, like, oh my god, I want a concierge to help me receive passes.
We went for viewing and everything. Then, one bedroom plus one study, $1.4 million.
Yeah. So, we had a friend who is doing property and, you know, we really wanted to support our friend. And when our friend told us about, okay, so this is how we break down
the payment for it. Everything.
And then back then he was saying like, okay, every month it's like 1,000 plus.
No, I think 2,000 plus.
They were like, it sounds okay leh. The house like so nice and you're so new and everything.
Yeah.
Then after that, COVID came, his cafe closed. And then my stream of income also got cut off. So I think we were very lucky that in the end we didn't go for the condo and we went for resale instead.
Yeah, or else at the end of the day we have to try to pay the house until the qing, which is like
you
have your house already, then you will never stay at home. You have to keep going out to work.
You don't get to enjoy your home as much. And then imagine every month you have to fork out like 2K, and that is before even you consider your food expenditure, you know, buying random little gifts for yourself and, you know, just splurging on Hai Di Lao meal, and you're like, oh my god, I need to eat bread and water for like one whole month because I need to pay for my house. So for us, we are quite like, we want a chillax life. We don't want to be so stressed up and like, oh my god, every month I need to fork out 3-4K. If your salary is like very fixed and very stable, right, then I think go ahead and buy a house that you can afford. But if let's say right now you are at a point where you are not sure whether you can really, really afford the home, or you know, you are
you
very
don't want
scared
to
that,
struggle to make like every month.
Correct. Like your paycheck entirely, you pay for your home and you are at home for maybe 8 hours just to sleep. You don't get to fully enjoy your home. Yeah. I think that is quite stressful for us. That's like how we think lah.
Yeah, ultimately, we watched the Netflix show. What is that show called?
Tiny Home?
Yeah, so everybody tiny there, home, they just want house. To have a debt-free life.
Debt-free life, mortgage-free or whatnot. Yeah. They don't want to be burdened by debts.
Yeah, after we watched the show, we got a bit like...
really inspired. We're like, oh, hey, our house is like kind of small and, you know, every month we are paying, I think, 700 plus.
Yeah, we pay around $700+ via CPF.
And we don't have to top up cash from our savings. So we can still like, okay, today we're going to eat something nice. Today we're going to go to a restaurant. Or some days we just tap out something cheap. Yeah.
Okay, and this brings us to the next point. Do you know how much you're actually paying for your house?
So I think for most of us, when we pay for our HDB, we actually take like a 25-year loan.
Yeah, because so we want to like, stretch out and...
We want to pay a little bit each month, right?
Yes, and then there's two loans for you to choose. Number one will be a HDB loan.
And then bank loan.
And then bank loan.
Mm.
And then for us, at that point of time, we're like, okay, we don't know anything at all. So we're like, okay, HDB basic loan, easier, HDB, easier. Yeah. So okay, HDB loan. So the interest for HDB loan is 2.6% per annual. So we don't have much CPF.
He started working earlier.
Yeah, so we used to drain out all our CPF to pay for the house. Then the remaining balance, we use it to take the loan. So when we took the loan, we're like, wow, actually affordable, $700+ a month only. Then after that, we realized one day, we just sit down and we count that, hey, actually the 2.6%, we charge out by 25 years, we total we pay around $57,000 worth of interest.
So ultimately, although we think that our house is only $268,000, that's quite cheap, right?
Mm.
Actually, if you count like the net lah plus the interest from your loan and whatnot, right?
It's
like $300+ K for a resale home that is like 60+ years left.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's not as cheap as you think about it.
If you have a house which is way more expensive, like say $500K,
mm.
and then you took a loan and then you choose to take a HDB loan for like $300K. Actually, the interest rate is only 100K, you know.
Correct. So this is something that you can consider before you buy your house. So what some people do is if let's say you have excess savings on hand, which is you cater aside some for emergency fund in case something happens or you get retrenched and don't have income for a few months, you have your emergency fund aside.
And you have some spare cash.
You can actually use it to pay off your home so that you don't accumulate so much interest over 25 years.
So we put a sum inside, and then after that we realized that the interest really dropped by a number of years.
Quite enough. And you don't underestimate like the 2.6% accumulation, or actually it's a lot less. And if you put the cash into your bank, the bank doesn't give you that much interest. You're not even getting like 2.6%, okay? Please check your bank account and how much interest you're getting.
So our friend told us like, okay, you think about this. This is 2.6% interest. If you have anything like if you have any other investment that
is higher than
2.6, then you should go for the investment and then use that money to pay off the house.
Yeah.
So that is more worth it. But
because
so far,
you are like offsetting.
Yeah.
You're winning the interest rate from your loan. But if let's say you don't have any like good kang tao for investment at the moment, and you are not sure whether or not this amount of money in your bank you put elsewhere, right, can give you more than 2.6%, then it's actually better off to put a part of it to cover the loan for your house.
So HDB loan is 2.6% per annum. And then there's the other option that you can choose is like bank loan. So there's a lot of bank for you to choose, and their rate right now is very, very attractive.
Yeah.
As low as 1.15%, which is like half of it. So for us, we chose HDB loan first.
Yeah.
And then after that, our friend recommended, hey, y'all should change to bank loan. Then y'all save a lot more interest. Okay. Then after that, we try to contact different banks and say, hey, we would like to refinance and change it to your loan. Then they ask us how much is our loan left. And then we tell them already, and they tell them, oh, sorry, your loan is too little. We don't want to...
Yeah, they don't want to refinance our house for us because the amount is not enough for them to earn a lot from the interest rate. So they're like, never mind, I don't want you as a customer.
Yeah, so for example, for us, we are stuck with just a HDB loan.
Yeah.
So right now for us is we are trying to...
if we have spare cash, we will try to
pay
for the home so that we can reduce the interest rate as much as possible. Because I was telling him, actually, if you count the interest rate, right,
it's like you work 1 year or 2 years. It's like you work for 1 year.
Or 2 years for
free. Or 2 years, for free. That's to pay for the interest for the house.
Correct. So if let's say you have any spare cash at the moment, I think you can consider taking a portion to put into your HDB loan, unless you have a better kang tao that can earn you more than 2.6% interest.
Yes. Or if you haven't got your house yet, and then you see the selling price of the house, you need to like take in consideration, okay, after I take the interest from HDB or bank loan, how much is the house actually cost.
Yeah.
Yeah, for example, 300k house, actually it might be around 350k, 360k plus all the interest rate.
But of course, there are like different benefits of choosing HDB loan or bank loan. Let's say sometimes bank loan, the rates are not as attractive.
After 3 years, I think you need to refinance again. Yeah, then you jump to another bank and see which one is more attractive. That
but
means
it's like, more fun.
In at the end, you save money.
Correct.
Yeah.
But if you want fast free, of course, then you just choose HDB lah. And then also, our friend told us, I don't know how true this is, that if you choose bank loan, if really anything choy happens, the bank will chase after you for money. But if choy really anything happens, HDB won't chase after you for money. This is from my friend. I mean, do your own research.
We don't know how true this is.
Hopefully, choy it doesn't happen lah. Okay.
Another thing to take note of is a lot of people want to get a house for investment purpose. Yeah. So for us, we never thought about that at all.
which is why we chose a
30-year-old house, which a lot of people in the comment they write, this one got no more resale value after that. So we know lah, but ultimately we want to just stay here lor, stay until we pian lao lor. And my sister, who have some like
experience in the bank, she told us about this term called accrued interest. Because when you buy a home, you get your proximity grant, you get your first timer.
Yeah, so there's a lot of grant from government that if you stay near your parents, if your house is near your parents, you will get 20,000 to 30,000 off. Yeah. The grant lah, rebate lah. And then if you're a first time couple, you get this amount also. And if your combined salary is within this amount, you'll get grant as well.
Correct.
So all these grant they give you, you minus from your house, you minus from the total amount, it's like, wow, our house like 50% discount eh, like become like 100+ K only. But the thing is, after that, once you sell the house away, you have to pay back whatever grant you took from the government that gave you, plus the interest that is inside. Yeah. Pay back everything.
Correct. This
will go back to your CPF, yes. Correct. But this is what we understand.
You guys might want to read a bit more about it because the logic behind it is, by right, if let's say all this money are put into your CPF, you would have accumulated a certain amount of interest from CPF.
Yes.
Okay. But because you use it to pay for the home,
yes.
That is why if let's say you were to sell off your home, right, all these grants plus the interest you have to pay back.
Okay, example, you bought a house at 300k. Okay, then you sell the house at 400k. So you will get additional 100k, correct? But throughout you use your grant and then your interest is supposed to be in the CPF, right? The 100k they will reduce, and then maybe you only have around 30k or 40k. The rest of the 60k will go into your CPF.
And we're paying 700 plus for our home every month using CPF, right?
Yes.
If one day we were to really sell off our home, we have to pay the interest for all these like 700
yes.
Like this.
A lot of money will go into the CPF instead of turning into cash proceeds. That correct. Means that like what people say like we won't profit if we sell the house. Ultimately, it's up to you guys to like decide like, okay, do I want to stay long in this house? Is this house going to be like for investment? Like for example, if I have a BTO at Tanjung Pagar, that one of course is an investment, can be investment. But if you are choosing like places that are quite ulu one, then you stay there, then maybe you can think like, okay, maybe I stay long already. After that, maybe I can move and stay with my parents to take care of my parents.
Mm.
And then the house, I can use it, I can rent it out as a passive income. There are people that do it this way as well.
So what Sean is saying is, if you don't want to pay all this accrued interest, right, then just don't sell the house. So some people just prefer to just rent it out after the MOP of 5 years.
Yes.
But of course, if let's say you are upgrading your home, selling off the old one to buy a new one, it's because you gain a lot of money, then in that case, maybe you have too much excess and you don't need to worry about accrued interest and whatnot. So I hope everybody hot and y'all can upgrade to a bigger home. I hope maybe next time we also can. But if we just remain as we are, I think our plan for the home ultimately would be to first pay off as much as we can.
Yeah, I think our end game is to like pay finish the house so we don't have any
we don't want so much
loans
debt,
or in, we want to be debt free. And then after that we can like decide like, hey, why not we take a 6-month break? Because we don't have to pay for a lot of things really, except like electrical bills and stuff like that. So you can like, okay, take a break for 6 months like that. So it's like enjoy life lah.
You know, not so
because
stressed.
She told me that since young, she never
I feel I was very stressed since I was a kid. So now that we are older, I'm just thinking, can I live my life in a more like relaxed carefree manner that I don't stress so much about work, about, oh my god, do I have income this month? Do I, you know?
It depends on, like, as a couple, what is your plan in the long run. Yeah,
and whether you guys can handle it together. Because there's no point you buy a very, very beautiful house, which is very, very expensive.
And yeah, and it's very big. And then, then after it, struggle to pay, meet ends. And then after that, the relationship, like, distant because of money.
So this is just a video to share with you guys what we have learned along the way after buying a home, and you know, things we should have considered before we bought a home, and things to consider after buying a home. I think these are things that we would share with people that we want to do well. Of course, we want to help the people around us to 省钱 and, you know, not be stressed over money and whatnot.
Yes.
And we hope that it has been helpful for you guys as well. Of course, it would be great if you can do your own research a bit more in depth and discuss with your partner.
As usual, thank you guys for watching, and we'll see you guys next time. Bye!